Hey, got his vote. Drive and we can start getting back, yeah?
Yeah. After
300 yards. You just need to find the postcode to Milton Keynes Estate Centre.
Should be recent destinations.
I think so.
Quite far back, actually, so.
February we went, now May. What address was it? it's sort of, yeah, I know where it is, not bad.
Past, back past Green.
Oh, they're very friendly here.
Well, why shouldn't they be?
Because it's London. Down past Greg's round over there somewhere, right. Next to the used car place. Yeah, that side lock.
Oh, there it is.
Gotta work out how to get in there.
While using the door. Don't leave your phone on display, because you know better than that.
No.
Come on. Thanks, Dan.
Oh, how are you welcome?
On the 20th of May, and be sure to check on your
This should be commentary from the race. Can you put that your side or not?
The number 26 G-Drive racing car, 143.1 last time around, means that he's now closing on Pierre Thirier as well, for fourth position.
We'll remind you that TDS in the 33 car are double stinting their Dunlops, we reckon. Slight question mark then for the second place car is, does it have enough fuel on board to reach the end? Olivier Pla is perfectly on schedule, heading into turn one. Very crowded down at that first corner. In stark contrast, here is Mathieu Vassivière on his own pretty much through turns one and two.
Also, the excitement from GTE, no doubt now, Miguel Molina is catching the leader. 6.9 seconds now, that's almost half.
Can we just leave this on? This is my race.
Okay.
You enjoy your trip.
He's been doing that for a little while now, and the Spaniard is full health. We know Matteo Cairoli is recovering from a recent illness and expressed to Charlie George yesterday after qualifying that he's not been feeling great for the last couple of days.
Are they?
We had assurances from Giorgio Roda, though, that he is feeling much better today. Careful, Olivier, trying to stick a lap here on the high-class racing. Dallara, the gap, though, closed very swiftly by Anders Fjordback. Pla tries the other side and is successful. Wally Pla slipping a lap on the 49 car. But it could all go wrong every time you encounter another car to lap. Always got to be sure which side of the track they're going to go.
Better news still, by the way, for the races to jump on this power slide through there, is that there are a number of teams just had a little bit of bad luck. Here's one of them, the AVF squad behind Panis Partez, another, and for that matter, the Enix Volcar. Those three cars in a row have been rapid this weekend. All three of them potentially race-winning cars for the races to come.
Yeah, it certainly bodes well for the rest of the year, doesn't it? Tereschenko does not stand a chance there versus Julien Canal, who throws one at the inside, and Tereschenko gave him plenty of room. So that is a seventh position now for Julien Canal in the Panis Partez Competition car.
It's
the
a
ABF machine. Slight risk here, it's going to go backwards another place because Paul Chatat is right behind as well in the 28 car. And in fact, Tereschenko's going to pit. So is that a drama with the car, or is it a bit more fuel that's required to get that Dallara to the finish? 21.5 minutes to go. Bottas out of turn 7 goes a little bit farther on lap 117, and the gap is 9 seconds back to Mathieu van der
Poel.
Continues to close between Matteo Cairoli and Miguel Molina. It's down to 6.5 seconds now in the battle of the GTE. And here it is. There at least is Cairoli.
Keep an eye on just how far back. About 12 seconds, you're quite right to say, Willie. Again, half a second trimmed in that first sector. More even Stevens, where the Porsche does pick up an advantage in that second sector down in this belt. There it is. It's roughly the length of the final straight to pit in. I think he's closed that gap again this time around. 5.6 seconds now. Not the first time we've seen JMW Motorsport chasing down the lead and the win in the final phases of the European Le Mans Series race here at Paul Ricard.
Meanwhile, third position still being held by Fabio Babini in the GTs. EB Motors making the step up to the European Le Mans Series.
That's not actually my race.
Is it not?
No. Sorry.
Team UK is how close we are.
Stop it.
What should I say about it?
It's wrong. Don't open your drink unless you're ready to drink it all. Finish mine first.
Turn right, half road, then
yeah.
Turn left, somewhere road.
Okay, I'm not sure if you heard that or not. That. Didn't hear that. But I imagine that there was a conversation about the debris. It may have nearly right or something. But the potential weakness for the Porsche is all the cooling radiators all the way around the front of the car. And a bit of debris bumped over.
It's also the fact that if it's gone underneath the car, it's damaged to the front splitter, which is front aerodynamic grip, which means it's got all the heat thrill of the car. Balancing grip,
yeah.
As well as that, you've also got the chance of a puncture. Yeah, puncture is done by a tire pressure monitoring system that's in the car, so you'll be displayed. It's on the driver's cockpit, but also behind. Here we see it again as Mukka leading and then Tigno behind just at that moment
track.
As he turns right up the hill. Then the car just doesn't turn at all and goes straight in.
Initial
looking at it, something on the left front.
No,
because also
we're close to the airport.
We're
going to have to get your
right
tip.
Rear as well.
Yeah.
And that was a very.
Yeah.
You see, again, there's Tony Kanaan like you with the racer's eye. That's not a driver's error.
Well, we know because we've been in it, and you know just instantly where the car should be going. That's the first thing, is that he's got out of the car and walked out unaided. Big shunt, there'll be a lot of repairs, but that's a very good team.
Team turning up.
The next car ready for the pre-test, but we're very fortunate that I think we'll step away from what is the very second man from GT.
Are they out of the running, but it's Torpedo, the 81 car, below the waistline as well.
First hour standings in the opening race of the WC Super Season to it, leading from the two Rebellions and SMP Racing's number 17 car. A lap behind the number 7 Toyota that started from the pit lane, a lap down yet to unlap itself in the LMP2 category. Racing Team Nevins ahead of Dragon Speed and Jackie Chan DC Racing.
You look left, you can see something, mate. That's the runway there, though.
Of the two Porsches, and Aston Martin's 98 for Ancar, the head of Team Project One's Porsche, with GF Sports Aston up to third, currently under safety car conditions because of a high speed accident. Harry Chimble is out of the race. Grabbed up by the cars on lost time, been caught in a pit lane by the safety car.
Oh, we're going up the road that we were watching across. Look.
Greatest circuits, set the scene for one of the world's
Started, that will be the line. And that is a tribute to Arnold Martin, the Martin Brothers.
But Sebastian Buemi again will have energy in hand, so he'll be able to weave and warm up his tyres. And I should think of the next stop, Buemi will be out.
Straight on here, mate.
A change in their driver lineup.
Stop rules, okay, that gets away first.
then the 7. Cross around Jeremy about. Pitt's pit lane deep. It's a red light at the end of pit lane. Goes green quickly. Well, they've got dramas in pit lane. We've had dramas in a pit garage for what have been the LMP2 leader. Down into pit lane with Louise now, who's got Guido van der Garde. Will tell us what that's all about.
Guido van der Garde, you put in such a great performance early on in that stint, but we can see the car in the garage. What happened?
Yeah, it was going really, really well. I quite enjoyed myself out there. Of course, it's been 1 year I'm not racing, and to have a start like this, being leading after a couple of laps, pull away 20 seconds was just amazing. The car was driving absolutely nice. But it was a pity, we just started the safety car, we had a problem with the alternator, the battery, and we had to come in, so hopefully they can solve it now, and we try to go out again.
Okay, well, we hope you get out there soon.
Me too, thank you.
It's a tough one for Guido van der Garde. The team did a very good job, obviously, but alternator not recharging, and then they have to fix it. Carney's going to run for the rest of the race without it.
Just add, by the way, if you saw on the coverage the accident at the top of Eau Rouge into Radion for Harry Tinknell. What you may or may not have seen is Harry getting out the car under his own steam. He has got to the medical centre, Alan. That's perfectly normal in these instances.
Yeah, I know. You obviously go for a checkup. That was a huge G impact, and so therefore it's not just necessarily physically jumping out the car, but it's also everything else that gets shaken around with it. Bruises and bumps tend to sort of come out, and little things come out when the adrenaline stops. And the adrenaline certainly still surging through the veins of the driver a little bit of time afterwards. Adrenaline surging through the veins of this man on board with Fernando Alonso, his first run in a race. We saw him yesterday. The car started in pole position, but he's doing a second stint in the race. And from his point of view, then he'll want to actually just get a clean run through this first stint. He knows what to do, there's no question about it. But
I should say, at this moment, leading the race is the number 3 Rebellion R13 in the hands of Thomas Laurent. That's a story as well. He could have clearly been chewing any time now, I guess at the end of this lap. But that's a driver that, 3 years ago was driving an LMP3 car, he's put under the wing of the Jackie Chan DC Racing team. Now racing with Rebellion in LMP1, and comes down pit lane as we speak. But Thomas Laurent just briefly led the race there, Andrew.
Yeah, but he nearly won Le Mans right last year, so therefore he's not led races before. But Gustavo Menezes, the American with a very Brazilian name, Brazilian heritage, jumping into the car. Gustavo has won the WEC in LMP2 before, stepping up into Rebellion in LMP1. And a complete set of tyres going onto that car, doing a full change. The driver lineup, I've got to be honest, in Rebellion is very, very strong. It's a really, really aggressive driver lineup as well, between experience of the... They've dropped the car. Lefrere's not on the car, so it's been dropped. That's it. The issue there is it's also the potential of additional damage that's done to the hub. Never mind, the bodywork's not so much, but more the hub if there's been anything there.
There'll be a bit of a look at what went wrong there, I'm sure.
But also have a very good look at it when they take the next wheel off at the next pit stop, and just to ensure that you haven't done any unnecessary damage.
Red light again at the end of pit lane. This is one of the new cars for the WEC this season, the Rebellion R13, derived from the hugely successful Orica 07 LMP2 car. Lighter, more advanced aero, but with the 4.5 version LMP1 engine, 4.5 litre version, the 4.2 litre Gibson LMP2 engine.
Yeah.
There's the cleanup with the belts and the barriers and things that you see there from the Ford accident. But just coming back, talking about LMP2 for a second, the leading Jackie Chan DC racing car, number 37, pit stop under investigation. And I don't know what the reason behind that is, but the 37 car leading LMP2 6 overall is under investigation.
That's very quick. Pit stops for Jackie Chan DC Racing. We're on Tan, the place of Jezwan Jafar in that car, the all-Malaysian crewed car that Martin was describing a little while ago. Won a race in the last season of the Asia Le Mans Series.
Traffic has changed. The traffic delay on your route is now 9 minutes. You arrive taking faster route.
Right.
What's the matter?
What do you mean?
I mean, what's the matter?
Nothing.
safety belt was off.
Safety, yes.
Yes, and it has to be said that certain cars in the safety train are offering different amounts.